one time. Here a while back I did a review of this frame. It's called the TC-R260. This is based off the QAVR, and this frame is a lot of fun to fly. Also, I did a review of these DYS SC2205 motors. These are called the Special Edition 2205. They're 2300 kV. And also the XM 20 amp ESCs, which are buried inside these little plastic housing things that they came with. Anyway, this thing has blown away my expectations. The SC2205 motors are extremely powerful, and the 20 amp ESCs have been holding their own. A lot of people said, why'd you use the 20 amp instead of using the 30 amp? The DYS guy told me the 20 amps would work. So that's why I used them, and so far he's been right. Now these motors, they will come down a little bit warm every now and then, but they've never been too hot. And as long as you don't burn your hand on them, they're gonna be okay. Stupid people are saying, oh, the magnet's gonna demagnetize because they're getting hot. No, whatever, maybe they will, but it doesn't matter. These things are awesome. Now, a lot of people say, well, should I build this quad? You know, should I build this one if I wanna fly? Sure, you can, but to show you guys, this is the one I actually started with. This is using DYS 1806 motors that are 2300 kV, and one's gold because I had to replace it when I crashed. I got tired of getting beat, so I ended up building this TC-R260 frame. And let me tell you, it is fast. Here I'm gonna go ahead and break this down a little bit and show you how I built this and the components that I used. So hopefully you actually learned something from this and it's good. If you already know how to build these things, then just skip the rest of this video and move on to another one. I'm also gonna do some line of sight flying, and I'm also gonna do some FPV flying with this. So we'll see how it goes. I started off flying with these dowel props. These are the 5x45x3. These things are nearly indestructible. Usually when I crashed and rolled, they just bend, and I just bend them back and keep flying. Well, because I got DYS motors, of course I have to try the DYS props. And these props are 6045s, maybe you can read it. 6045 props, and that's actually what I have on there right now. These ones do real well. These do excellent in U-turns, and just because they got three blades, they can grab a lot of wind. These, I'm anxious to try them out in a race. I haven't gotten the chance to try these yet in a race, but just flying at the field, these feel a lot faster. And other people have told me that they've flown the same motors and same ESCs with 6-inch props, bullnose like these, 6045 props, and they've reached almost 95 mile an hour. I don't know if that's true, but it seems really fast because my Emax motors, my red bottoms, I flew those and I got clocked at 63. So, I don't know. I'm gonna try these though, and hopefully somebody shows up with a radar gun to measure it. The 1300 size battery like this one that's rated 75C, this is kind of the de facto standard that a lot of people are racing with. And it's a 75C 4S battery, and it works real well. I did a drag race with this and it came down plenty hot, because as soon as you take off, you know, in a drag race, you're full throttle. I also flew with this 1600 4S battery. This is also a Bonka battery. And when it came down, it was warm and it was a little bit puffy, but I think it handled the full throttle a lot better than the 1300 did. If you look, there's a little bit of size difference between the two of them. But you know, it's not crazy heavier. They're about the same, almost the same width. The 1300 is a little bit fatter. But the weight's not too much more on these 1600s, and so I think these actually did a little bit better job for me in the drag race, although they did add a little bit more weight where these didn't have it. But we were doing a drag race with three laps, and so you really needed to have some endurance, and the 1300s on the last lap were just begging for mercy. But when they came down, they went back up to 14 some volts, so they were fine. The only actual frame modification I did to this was I shaved off this little bump. Over here on this side, you can kind of see the little ridge I'm talking about. It was interfering with the battery going in and plugging into this battery plug here, so I shaved that off. That's the only frame modification.
Back here in the back, you can see I'm using an ET200R. Originally, I was using a ET25R, so the 25 just means it's 25 milliwatts, and it worked fairly well at the drone races. I just had to wait till everyone else took off, and once they took off, then I could take off. But the 200 is a lot better. If you're gonna do racing, most of your people you race with are gonna use 200, and a lot of the races require 200 or weaker transmitters, or 250, because I think the Fast Shark started at 250. But do yourself a favor, just get a 200. Don't buy a 600 and think you're gonna be awesome, because you're gonna step on other people's video signals and they're gonna be mad at you. If you're planning on racing or flying with other people, get a 200. I took out the six screws up here on the top plate, so we'll go ahead and open this up and take a look inside here. Now up on the top plate here, you can see I got my video transmitter and also have my transponder for the races. And this is the iLapse one, and it shoots out the right-hand side. And this video transmitter is actually soldered directly into the power distribution board. And they said a lot of these higher voltage or higher KV motors will spike the output, will send power spikes down the power board for whatever reason. So actually I'm powering the video transmitter off a 12 volt output off of this MaTeC power distribution board. Also, the video comes over here and goes straight up to the camera up in the front. This is a naked X4RSB video receiver up here in the front that I use. And I use this because there's not a lot of room and I wanted it to take up as least amount of room as possible. And so the wires are actually soldered directly to it. This one is called naked because it doesn't come with any pins soldered onto it. So if I pull it up out of the way. Here, up here I don't have an HS1177 camera. This is a different one. This is actually a CMOS camera. And this one does pretty well. I took it to the flying field and I saw other people flying with the HS1177. Much better picture. As soon as I got home from the races, I went on and ordered one. This one looks like it. I got it because it's the right size or the same size and it fits between these two plates. With the single screw on both sides, and the plates actually pinch it a little bit more than it even wants to be, which is good because it gives a little bit more friction for when you're going to angle the camera up a little bit more to go a little faster, or down a little bit down a little bit more if you're going to do more of an agility type of flying. Now this board here, this one is actually using the SP3 racing board, and I like I said, I burned up two of these because of the dumb short in there, and I don't know where I got it, but I replaced all the wires and all the power distribution board, and it came out and actually works really well now. And I'm also using the X4RSB, and it's using these first three wires over here on this side, the power and the ground and the signal wire over there. And it's on the right side of these pins. I mean, I hooked it up on this side a dozen times and I'm like, why is it not working? Finally, I saw them like, let's put it on this side. And it worked the first time, amazingly enough. Here on this board, on this left side right here, I have this connection here. It's for the battery voltage. It's connected directly to the power distribution board, so the SP3 racing board will know how much voltage is left in the battery. Over here on this side, I have the piezo buzzer soldered directly on, and I have that there so that this thing can actually beep when it when it's getting ready to take off or arm or disarm. It also will be able to support the low voltage alarm. One more thing before I pull this board out of the way. These are all the pins that connect to your ESCs and whatnot. And over here on these far left, this far right side here, I guess, these are the bootloader pins. And they're over there on the far right. I go ahead and I solder pins into there because it seems like I always have problems getting new firmware on here, like Betaflight. And so by having the pins on there, it's easy to put a little jumper on there to solder those up, or take a screwdriver and just stick it inside there and, you know, stick it inside here and touch those together and then wait for it to start flashing and then pull it off. And anyway, having the pins on there makes it a lot easier for loading new firmware. I always hate moving these flight boards out of the way to try to get underneath there to show this stuff because I always feel like it's never going to go back together the way I had it this time. Let's see if I can get this out of here. So underneath here, see if I can turn this around. So underneath here you can see the MaTeC power distribution board. Now the 5 volt output there on the left, kind of right in the center of the screen, is going out to the flight board. And the 12 volt output on the right goes up to my camera. I think earlier I said I went to the video transmitter, but that's not right. It goes up to the camera. The video transmitter is powered directly off of whatever battery you plug into it, 3S or 4S. But also underneath here, kind of up here in this part, you can see that's the FreeSky battery voltage sensor, and I have that in there so it will send telemetry data back down to my Taranis. A lot of people say, how come we don't use the output on the flight board? Well, I did a long time ago, but I always had problems with it working 100% of the time. It worked about 80% of the time. But this FreeSky battery voltage sensor that's buried underneath here, it seems to work near 100% of the time. Whether the quadcopter is armed or not, it's always feeding the data back down to the flight board. Up here on top of the power distribution board where the connector is, you can see here the power distribution board supports 3 to 4S batteries. So don't try to run 5S batteries or 6S batteries through this power distribution board. And the restriction is probably more about the voltage reducers that are inside there rather than the thickness of the copper that it's using. So here's the bottom side of that power distribution board. You can see that my soldering skills did not shine when I soldered this on there. But it soldered on fine, and it holds fine, which is the main thing. How it looks is secondary, especially when it's down here on the bottom where no one's going to see it. Now the one nice thing that this frame has, and I covered it in the frame review board, or the frame review video, is that these screws here can all be removed without having to hold anything on the top plate, which makes it real nice for replacing your arms. Although with these arms being 4 millimeters, I don't know how you're going to manage to break these, at least not very easily.
There we go. And this is running with 6-inch props. So here we go. We get a couple burnouts here with it. And again, 6-inch props, they're from DYS. Here we go.
My TC-R260, I'm using an SP Racing F3 board, and it's been working real well for me. And I'm using Betaflight version 2.7.0. I usually just use the latest one that's available, and I usually have pretty good luck with it. Here on the configuration page, I have the motor stop disabled, so that way, I think it's disabled. It's turned off to the left, and I have it that way, so that way when I arm, I can see the motor spinning. And usually that's really good at the races because I can sit down and before we take off, I can look over there, activate the motors, see them spin up, and know that I'm getting good communication between my transmitter and my receiver. I also have one shot enabled and also have one shot enabled on my XM 20 amp ESCs. Now on the min throttle, it's important that you set these down to thresholds that are right for your quad, but if you use the same parts as me, these numbers should work pretty well for you. Down a little lower on the configuration page, I had to choose RX serial in the receiver mode and S-bus in the serial receiver provider, and that's because I'm using the X4RSB. Now if you're using a different one like PPM or some other D4R2 or some other receiver, your settings might be a little different. But on the battery voltage, I put a low voltage buzzer on my quadcopter so I'd actually hear it on the quadcopter itself, and also have telemetry coming back down to my Taranis. That way I have two chances of hearing the thing go off. Also, by having the buzzer on the TC-R260, you can hear the beep signals that the Betaflight wants to output, like when you activate or arm your motors and disarm your motors.
because we're using the X4 RSB, here on the ports page, we have to turn on the serial RX on the UART3, and that just tells the board that you're going to be receiving the SBUS signal across that channel. Everyone has their own idea of what the best tuning is. Well, I've always had good luck with the SP Racing F3 board when I use LuxFloat. And here are the PID settings that I've actually started using, and these work real well for me. The only thing I've changed since I recorded the video was I increased the D a little bit because I had a little bit of wobble at the end of rolls and at the end of flips, and the raising the D up just a little bit took care of that problem. Also, on the roll rate and the pitch rate and the yaw rate, I cranked these up a little bit so that it would be a little bit more sensitive. Now, I don't like to do flips and rolls in like half a second like some people do because I just get too confused in my head. But 75 seems to be a pretty good speed for me, and it's very controllable. Here on the receiver page, if you're using a Taranis, the correct lettering in the channel map should be AETR. And if they're not, or you see some of them are backward, you can switch around two of the letters, save it, and try it again. It should be okay. Also, over here on the right-hand side is where you can put in throttle expo if you want or some other stuff. But the only thing I did here was I added my RC rate up to 1, and I put my RC expo at 0.6 and the yaw expo at 0.2. And that's just so I get a little bit of expo inside the controller, and I can add more in my Taranis if I want to later. On the modes tab, I don't have anything set because I only fly in acro mode or whatever this thing has by default or whatever people are calling it. I don't do air mode because with the motor spin stuff, it keeps the motor spinning even when I go all the way down to zero throttle. The only other thing I do want to add on here, if I ever get around to it, is turning on the beeper settings so that way when I crash, I can flip the switch and it'll turn my beeper on. That's down a little lower, but I haven't messed with it yet. Spectacular crash into the scaffolding. This thing ate it pretty good. First thing I noticed was the antenna was loose on here and the video transmitter's hanging down, so I put a new zip tie on to hold the video transmitter on. Then I got to looking a little closer and I realized that this front post had hit the scaffolding, and you can even see some of the orange paint still on there. And it smashed up this thing pretty good. The front plate here got bent back. Both the poles in the back, the little spacers here, are both bent backward. And this side up here on the top plate got smashed up real good, and it is broken. And also, one of the screws holding my camera in popped out. But it held together. The arms held together. The bottom plate, look at this. This is a little odd. The bottom plate actually bent a little bit right here. Instead of cracking and breaking, it looks like it actually bent a little bit, which is odd. And the other thing is I lost two screws right here, and I don't know how those came out because they were tight before I took off. Anyway, this TC-R260 is one tough cookie, and I got another frame coming because I like this one so well. Anyway, TC-R260. This thing is awesome. I really like it. The guys who designed this frame originally, kudos to them, because it's sweet. Anyway, TCR260, if you got any questions about this, leave me in the comments. I'll try to help you out as best I can. KCFPV! Thanks for watching.